All right, well, we began 2 weeks ago. We started ministering along the lines of walking by faith. And, you know, this is something that we need to teach in the church every, I'd say every 9 to 12 months is your maximum space of time in teaching on faith. People need, why? Because, the Bible, the only thing in the Bible that tells us where to live by is faith. It doesn't say we're to live by love. It doesn't say we're to live by holiness. It doesn't say we're to live by sanctification. It doesn't say we're to live by, it says that we walk or live by faith. And so that is a very core and central subject to the life of the believer. And you can't get away from it. Now, we understand that that subject entails things like walking in love. You know, faith works by love. Amen. And we know that, if you want to see the Lord, you're going to have to live holy, because the Bible says without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Amen. You know, the Bible tells us that, we're to live a sanctified life. It teaches that, basically. Christ Jesus has been made unto a sanctification or separation. Now you're not separated from the world, but you're to be separated from worldly things or attitudes or lifestyles. And that's a different, doesn't mean you're separated from the world. We're to be, though you're in this world, you're not of this world. Okay? So, but we live by faith. So we began a couple weeks ago talking about faith in action. And talking about miracles, and there's some things we just didn't really get to, but I just want to say this: we live by faith. We walk by faith, amen. And so we're going to move on from where we started to the next thing, talking about confession, the key to unlocking faith. Now, in talking along this line, I was just getting you up to where we are, and we're jumping in now. Okay, confession. Now, when you think of the word confession, you can think a lot of things. You can think, if you have a Catholic background, you think about going to the priest and confessing your sins to the priest and him, giving you your penance or whatever you have to do in order to get, cleansed of whatever it was you're doing. I think when the question they ask when you first come in is, when was your last confession? I think in the movie Zorro, he says, when was your last confession? She said, last night. He said, what could you have done in that amount of time? Because he wasn't the priest. He was Zorro, and he's hiding in the priest thing. How many ever saw Antonio Banderas and Catherine Zeta-Jones? That's a good Zorro movie, by the way. And in the sequel is pretty good, too. But that one's a really good one. When we talk about confession, those different things come to our mind. Confess your sins one to another. And there are four types of biblical confessions. One is confession of sins of the Jews, as taught by John the Baptist. And Jesus in his ministry prior to his death, burial, and resurrection. Jesus, the ministry of Jesus technically is an Old Testament ministry. Technically. Now, I know that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are in what we call the New Testament or the New Covenant, but his ministry was an Old Testament ministry. He was walking under the law. Okay? Now, he was to fulfill the law. Can't think not that I came to do away with the law. I came to fulfill the law. In other words, I was to meet the requirements of the law at every point to redeem mankind out of his destruction, because no one could do it. Okay? And so John's baptism was not Christian baptism. John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. The Christian baptism is a baptism of acknowledgement. Water baptism for the believer is an acknowledgement of a work that's already taken place in the life of the believer. Okay? Now, Christian baptism is, as far as, technicality, is the believer or the unregenerated man being baptized into Christ, being born again, and being raised into newness of life. That is a spiritual work. Amen? For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Okay, and then water baptism is a outward profession of that inward work. Water baptism does not save you. It just doesn't. No, how do you get saved? You get saved by confessing Jesus as Lord and believing God's raised from the dead. And at that point, the Holy Spirit baptizes you into the body of Christ and raises you up in newness of life. You become a born-again believer. The water baptism then signifies that work and is an ordinance of the church that we should follow. We are to be baptized in water. We're to be baptized. We should be. It is biblical. We know from the book of Acts, people were saved and weren't baptized in water. Should we forbid these being water, being baptized with water, seeing they believed as we did? See, they're already believers. Then they were baptized in water. So it is it's a act of public profession of your acknowledgement of Jesus Christ as your Lord. Okay, so the confession, so we have confession of sins of the Jews taught, confession of the sinner today. Now, the sinners, according to John 16, 7 through 11, the only sin they're convicted of is not believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. You know what sends you to hell? Not believing on Jesus. Not confessing his lordship. That's what gets you, that's your one-way ticket. Now look over in, we can look over in John 16, 7 through 11. He says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the comforter, now the parakletos, or paraklete, you know, paraklete is the shortened version. This actual word in this is one of the variants of that word, and it's parakletos. Is not expedient for you that I go away? For if I go not away, the paraclete will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, of sin because they believe not on me. See, you have to be convicted or convinced that and judged that you don't believe on Jesus. And the Holy Spirit, that is his work. Now, we spend a lot of time in the body of Christ trying to trick people into coming into our churches, trying to have cool stuff to get them in the door, and we leave the work of the Holy Spirit out to reprove their hearts. We need to turn the Holy Ghost loose on folk. Amen. Let him do his work. Don't sit there and try to tell them they're okay, I'm okay, you're okay. Let's sing Barney song together. I love you, you love me. You know, and have Baby Bop show up. Talk about how much we love each other. Want to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. You know. Or is it two-part harmony? Which anybody remember how the old Coke song went? Perfect harmony. Okay, thank you. You know, the hippies. See, I grew up in the hippie age. You know, all the hippies up on the mountaintop singing Coca-Cola and having world peace. They were so messed up. I mean, I was kind of on the tail end of that, but that was a messed up generation. Listen, I know. I live part of that. Okay? We were some messed up people. And then it's tried to make a comeback. Remember, how many remember about 15 years ago they put the peace symbol on cars and started saying, backed by popular demand. What, by the devils? You know, because the peace symbol was a broken, inverted cross. Anyway, you can find that out. All right, I better go off my soapbox. What do y'all think? Remember, I came to nice pastor head bobblehead. All right, I had him on my desk before service checking out the head motion there. Jenny said, be careful with that thing, it was expensive. Yeah, but it's cool. Yeah, there we go. All right, of sin because they believe not on me, of righteousness because I go to my Father, you see me no more, of judgment because the prince of the world is judged. And so, you know, the believer or the sinner confesses the lordship of Jesus in order to come out of that place. Romans chapter 10. What's this got to do with faith? Look, just hang with me. Romans 10, 8. It says, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. I love people who run around and say that, you know, Paul only preached the gospel of grace. He called it the gospel of grace. So therefore, everything about the Bible is the gospel of grace. But here he called it the word of faith. We got to get undogmatic about things that aren't dogmatical. I know that kind of sounds weird, but does it work?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, that is the word of faith which we preach. How's the word of faith? That if we'll confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So here we got another confession. Not the confession of the Jewish confession of our sins, but here we got the confession or the acknowledgement of the lordship of Jesus and the belief in the heart. And understand this, Bible faith and Bible confession always works in conjunction with believing in the heart.
Yeah.
Okay?
That's good.
Okay? And so we confess with our mouth and we believe in our heart, and that confession is made unto salvation. Soterios, the noun of the Greek verb sozo, word group, salvation, saved. Okay? And so we have here, Paul writing and saying there's a confession of the unbeliever to confess the lordship of Jesus and come into the kingdom. Amen? To confess that Jesus is Lord and come into the kingdom. So there's another confession. Well, see, and once you get saved, you don't confess Jesus as Lord anymore to get saved. Now, you can declare his lordship and that he is Lord of your life and that as a testimony, but you don't get saved again. That's a one-time event. Let me say this. It's only a one-time event. You're a Calvinist. No. You can only get saved once. If you ever mess around and get into Hebrews chapter 6, you can't get saved again. See, I'm not Arminian. I'm not Calvinist. I'm Calminian. Okay? I'm in between the Calvinists and the Arminian extremes. Okay? I believe we are secure in the Father's hands. As long as we maintain that position and we don't meet the qualifications of Hebrews 6, where we trample underfoot the blood of the Son of God and count the blood of the covenant, where we're sanctified an unholy thing. I know somebody that's done it. They cursed, they talked to the husband and said, "I spit in the face of your God." And they were born again, filled with the Holy Ghost, spoke in tongues, prophesied, walked with God, knew the Word of God. I helped lead them to the Lord. I know them. I know the walk that they walked in. And then they write blogs on the internet mocking the blood of Jesus. They got devils. They've given themselves over. But let's look right at their spouse and go, "I spit in the face of your God." Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Don't tell me that they're still going to heaven. Oh, they got saved. They were never saved. I beg to differ. I know. I was part of helping lead them to the Lord. I saw them get filled with the Holy Ghost. I saw them prophesy under the anointing. I know who the Holy Ghost is, all right? I saw them flow in the gifts of the Spirit. I witnessed it. I was there. Now I've witnessed this. My heart broke. But you know what? No unction, no ability to even pray for them. You wanted to. Lord, help them. Yeah. There's nothing. Why? Fear of God doesn't always strive with man. People do that, and once they've trod on their foot the blood of the Son of God, the Bible goes on and says this: there remaineth no more sacrifice. There remaineth no more sacrifice. See, that can't happen. Well, Bible says it can, and I've seen it. Now, if the Bible hadn't said it, then I would, if the Bible said, well, they can do that and come back if they want to. But the Bible says there remaineth no more sacrifice. So that, you know what? There remaineth no more sacrifice. So anyway, this confession, sorry. Kind of got solemn when you got over there, didn't you? Oh, Jesus. Help me, Lord. I was going to stay on my notes. Let me share something with you. Because, see, I saw the whole process of how this happened. We had an assistant pastor in our church. And I ended up on my church staff in Greenville as one of the assistants. Before me, there was another assistant. And this person used to say, "Oh, I love pastor, the senior pastor. But I really love to hear so-and-so preach." That was the other assistant. And I called him aside one day when I heard him say that. I said, "No, look. So you need to understand something. It's easy to like the guy who gets it and gets to preach all the fun stuff." Right. Okay? That associate has no responsibility for your life.
Yeah. This is good.
He's an aide and assistant to the senior pastor to help get the job done. But in that sense of spiritual authority, the senior pastor is the one who's got to give an account for your soul with joy. He's the one that's got to get up and preach stuff that you don't want to hear that's going to help your life.
Yeah, this is right. This is good to say.
And then the guy gets to get up every few months or every once a month or every 2 months or whatever and gets to preach his, happy, hula hoop sermon. Going to the happy clappy church. Oh. Woo! It's all fun. I mean, that's what I did. I didn't preach correctional sermons when I was an associate. I preached the happy clappy sermons. I'd spit cotton six rows back, baby. We'd have them running in the aisles. Love to hear Pastor Ed preach, you know. Well, Pastor so-and-so's got to get up. He's got to get up and preach and say, now listen, you can't be living with somebody else's wife. All right? Well, she would say this. She would say, I just love to hear him preach. And she would never listen. Just had an affinity for the other guy. Well, eventually, you see what happened. What happens when that happens? See, people don't follow the trail of stuff. They just think, see, one day they got to a point as a family, they no longer respected the senior pastor. Well, it didn't start out, I don't respect the senior pastor. It started out, I love him, but I sure love to hear so-and-so preach. And the devil used that to drive a wedge in. And then he no longer had an authority in their life. And when they came to leave, he tried to speak into their life, and they just totally rejected what he had to say. Went out and did what they had to do. What they had to do. They thought they had to do. Well, you know, they were homeschool family. Next thing you know, they're never going to church anywhere. They're just all at home. Yep. And then it just kept going. And not submitted to authority. Not listening. And before you know it, she's out here and ozone layer. I mean, you know, with some guru and, you know, and all this weird Eastern religious stuff. Well, see, that door opened way back with a slight disrespect for the spiritual authority in her life. Doesn't mean your spiritual authority is always right. That never means that. Doesn't mean that they're God, they can't miss it. But they are the spiritual authority in your life. And if you don't believe that, go join Miriam and Aaron outside the camp. Because what did they say to when they wanted to, you know, demand equality in leadership? God speaks to us too. And God had something to say about that. I know we're over here, but I'm telling you, if you don't get this, you'll never get faith. God stepped in at that point in time.
Yes, he did.
He said, yeah, I speak to you, but I speak to Moses face to face. And she was smitten with leprosy and had to be put without the camp. And Moses had to intercede for her.
And he did.
See, what you usually find out is the leader usually has the right heart.
Yeah.
People trying to usurp authority and leadership don't. And so he went and interceded for her, and God cleansed her of her leprosy, and she was able to come back to the camp after 7 days. I think it was 7 days. That disrespect for it. What's that got to do with faith? If you can't submit to authority and can't respect authority, you can't understand faith. Because faith is an authority-based force in our lives. For example, the centurion with the servant, Jesus said, I'll come and heal him. And the centurion said, you don't need to come. Just speak the word only. For I am a man set under authority. I'm submitted to authority. And I say to this one, go, and he goeth. To the one, come, and come. He cometh. To this one, do this, and he doeth it. The reason he exercised authority was because he was submitted authority, and he recognized the authority of Jesus because he understood authority.
Yeah, right. That's really good. That's a good word.
Mm-hmm. And so Jesus said, I haven't found so great a faith in all of Israel. His faith was developed, or his faith was great because he understood and lived in the parameters of submission and exercising of authority.
Yeah.
That made his faith great. See, all the people running here, I don't have to be submitted to this. I don't have to listen to that. I can do whatever I want to do. Go ahead. You think you got faith? You don't have nothing. You're a bozo. I said, you're a bozo. I'm confessing the word. I got it. Honey, I can tell you what. If you're not submitted, you ain't going to get nothing. You're a bozo. That was for the camera. Oh, bobbleheads. I'm telling everybody that I came as a pastor at bobblehead tonight. That's my costume. Need a pair of glasses for my bobblehead. Anybody not get to see the bobblehead? Oh, you've already seen it? Okay. All right. That all came because I was saying that you only confess the Lordship of Jesus to get saved one time, and you can only do it one time. You can only come into the kingdom and be born again once. Okay? You can only get that, you only get one opportunity to get that done when you were born again from death unto life. That's it. You get that one time. Now, you can live that way the rest of eternity and not lose that. You don't have to lose it. And you don't have, you know, committing the unpardonable sin is not as easy as some people think. See, growing up Pentecostal, man, I'm going to tell you something. Here's how, because they're Armenian. And that basically the excess of that is along this line, that if, Jerry walks up here, and for some reason he just takes a notion to grab that mic stand and hit me upside the head, and I cuss. And right after I cuss, the Lord Jesus Christ came back and raptured the church, I'm dying and going to hell.
Yeah.
Because there's sin in my life.
Right.
You see, that's an extreme.
Yeah.
The other extreme is, I can go out and shoot dope, run around with women. I mean, rob banks, murder people, you know, because I got saved when I was 10. And it doesn't matter. And, you know, Jesus comes, I'm going to heaven because once saved, always saved. It just doesn't matter what I do. Those are excesses. That's why I say I'm a communist. I'm in the middle. Okay? You can't be in the extreme on either one of those positions. Okay? Mm-hmm. Because they're wrong. You can lose your salvation, but it's not as easy as you cuss because you stubbed your toe. And you shouldn't be cussing. And the Lord doesn't like it. Hello. But it's not going to send you straight to hell. It's not your straight to hell card. Do not go to heaven. Do not pass go. Go straight to hell. That's not it. All right. I know I got off a little bit, but that was, you know, so that confession only happens one time. Now, for the believer. The believer's confession of his sin when he is out of fellowship with God. Brother Hagin used to say, faith cannot sing when fellowship is broken. When you're out of fellowship with God, it's hard to be in faith. Why? There's something between. If our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God, the Apostle John said in 1 John. Amen? Hallelujah. Now you got, now see, Jesus. Psalm 137. I'll tell you, sometimes you just wish you hadn't heard some of the stuff other people say. You really do. Then as a pastor, you realize you got to deal with stuff or other people get messed up with it. You know? The great grace preacher's coming to America to bring his message here. It's already got here, messed up a bunch of stuff in advance. Grace does it, but excesses and subjects will. Psalm 137, by the rivers of Babylon there we sat, yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof, for there they carried us away captive, required of us a song, and that wasted us, required us of myrrh, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Now, that's what you are. When you get into sin, you're like in a strange land. And you don't have a song of faith. It's hard to have a song of faith when you know there's stuff in your heart that's wrong. It is. I like my Bible. I wanted to bring him out and use him as a prop, but I'm probably break him, so I don't want to do that. I don't go to my office and he's leaned over like this all the time. he broke his neck. Look at 1 John 3. Starting in verse 3. And every man hath this hope in him, purifieth himself even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is a transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifest to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Now the word there, sinneth not, does not mean you never act, you never miss the mark. It's in a tense of the verb and with the implication of practicing sin. Okay, we mean practicing sin. You're habitually doing it. All right, if you're abiding in Him. Now, listen, it didn't say if you're born of Him. It said if you're abiding in Him. So you can't abide, spend time in fellowship with the Lord, and practice sin. So what usually happens? People stop abiding. They're born of God, but they'll run off and hide from the Lord. Because you can't practice sin.
Yeah.
Hello? We're all older in here. Okay. It's like a husband and wife. Now, usually one of them can tell if the other one's having an affair. That was too sweet. A living in adultery. Why? Because when intimacy with their spouse comes to play, it's not there. Something's wrong. Some people may engage in relations in order to try to cover up what they're doing, but something's wrong. Why? Because you cannot be intimate with someone that your spouse when you're engaged in an adulterous relationship with somebody else, because your heart's somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Okay? And so if that's going on, then you don't have fellowship. And so what begins to happen is the relations between the married couple usually become spaced out further and further and further and further. And then finally somebody goes, what's wrong? Nothing's wrong. Everything's fine. Well, you never touch me anymore. We never have relations anymore. And it's all because all they think about is getting in the sack with somebody else. Now, I know that's kind of maybe a crude example, but it's true. Now, let's look at it this way. Our relationship with God is intimate. And when you begin to engage in practicing sin, you are violating that intimate relationship of a holy relationship with the Father. And so you don't want to be intimate. And I'm not, you don't get weird. But you don't want to be in an intimate, close, loving time with the Lord because that other thing is there. And you're just looking for the next opportunity to go smoke some dope or shoot up or have sex with somebody that you're not married to and all that stuff. See, he that abideth in him. Now, if you're constantly intimate with your spouse and you're just in love with your spouse, you're not going to want to go be with somebody else. Hello? You're not going to want to be with somebody else. Because they're the love of your life. Hello. That's what men. Well, of course, you guys say it to women now, but because they're starting to get addicted to pornography too. But I'm telling you, pornography is designed to supplant the intimacy with your spouse. It's designed that way. To get your brain to violate and to enter into an arena of intimacy breaker and draw you away somewhere else. Now, sin is designed to do the same thing. And let's face it, people who engage in adulterous relationships, whether physical or internet visual pornography or sexting or sex chat lines or whatever, are violating and breaking that intimate relationship with their spouse. They're not abiding with their spouse. Because if they were, instead of getting on the internet, they'd be with their spouse. Okay? Instead of trying to find a way to get down the hallway to the computer and to get on the computer, they would be in bed with their spouse. Do y'all want to go over there? If you are abiding with the Lord, you're not looking for the opportunity to go out into sin. So it says, he who abides in him sinneth not, or doesn't practice sin. Doesn't mean you don't stumble and kick your toe or make a mistake here and there. Okay? Now, and let me just say something. You don't accidentally have adulterous relationships. There's way too much planning that goes into it. I mean, you just don't ride out and go to the store, and while you're at the store, you go, hey, let's go have sex by accident. One time when Pastor Scott Webb was here with us a number of years ago, y'all know where the Ferrari place is now, Foreign Cars Italia? Well, that had been something, and it was just sitting there. We wouldn't look at it, possibly think about, well, maybe we make a good church. He said, let's go look at some buildings. So we went out and looked at the building. And so we drive through the parking lot. There's a car sitting out there. And the door's open on the side. And we rode by. Uh-oh. And yeah, they were. Right there, hanging out of the car. And he said, did I see what I thought I saw? I said, I think so, Pastor. He said, turn around. Yeah, that's exactly what we thought. You gotta be kidding me. That didn't happen by accident. That's probably some hot lunch date. They thought about it all day. See, if they had been thinking about their spouse, they wouldn't be thinking about that. If you're abiding in the Lord, you're not thinking about ways to sin. You're not practicing sin. When you're being intimate with the Lord, spending time in the Lord, spending time in His presence, you know, hit the perfume of His glory and of His holiness saturates you. And it's hard to go sin when you come out of the presence of the Lord, because it makes you feel unclean. Now, so what happens? A lot of people go get unclean, and because they don't want to go back into His presence, they stop abiding, and they just go live in the unclean because that way they don't have to deal with it. Well, you know, your conscience gets seared. Wow. All right. Whosoever abideth in Him does not practice sin. Whosoever practices sin has not seen Him nor knows Him. Now, you can be born of Him but not know Him. Okay? Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth or practices sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifest, that He might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not practice sin. His seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God. You can't practice sin if you're born of God. Now, not Mr. Mark, practice it. Habitually live there. All right? And this is the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth his brother. For this is the message that you've heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We'll stop right there. All right. So, I should have stopped the verse earlier. So we have here this problem. Now, if we'll back right over here to 1 John chapter 1. Oh, the big new scripture that everybody preaches against. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He's faithful. Now, He says here, you confess our sins. See, unbelievers do not confess their sins. We already read that. They confess Jesus as Lord. Mm-hmm. You don't confess your sins when you get saved. You repent. You confess Jesus Christ as Lord. You believe God raised Him from the dead. How could you confess all your sins in the first place? You don't know them. Now, growing up Pentecostal, we also used to always receive communion this way. Lord, if I got any sins that I know about or don't know about, whether commission or omission, forgive me. Why? Because we didn't want to die. Because for this cause, many are weakly and sickly among you, and many sleep. Well, it wasn't because you messed up this week that you're going to die at the communion table. But boy, we were all making sure.
Yeah.
Telling you, buddy, we're going to make sure we didn't have anything. No, it is a good time of introspection. It is a good time to judge yourself. But you shouldn't approach the Lord's table in fear. Man, we were like, dear God, before I drink this cup, if there's anything in there, Jesus. Okay? Now, if we say we don't have sin, we lie. If you say you never sin, you lie. If you say that you weren't a sinner before, you lie. Now, listen. I am not a sinner saved by grace. I was a sinner. I was saved by grace. Now I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. I don't confess that I'm a sinner saved by grace. If you're going to say, at least say I was a sinner who was saved by grace. I'm now a child of God. I'm an heir of God. I'm a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Okay? Now, if we confess our sins, He is faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess our sins, He is writing to believers. Amen. He said in verse 4, these things I write unto you that your joy may be full. He said in verse 7, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another in the blood of Jesus Christ. His Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. We have to get up and say, I never sinned. Well, you're a liar. You're a lying like a hound dog on the front porch on a hot summer afternoon in the South. Bloodhound. All right, they don't even get off the porch unless they got to go chase something. And then they don't chase it. It's going, oh, anyway. If we confess, who confesses? The believer, when you miss the mark, you confess your sin.
Yeah.
You acknowledge it. Why? To have a cleansing so your heart doesn't condemn you.
Yeah, right, right.
Why is it important that your heart don't condemn you? So that you have confidence toward God. The see, we got people teaching people not to confess their sin, and so they hold, listen, this whole thing that's supposed to be setting them free is putting them into bondage. Why? Because your heart will condemn you. When there is anything between you and the Father, your heart will condemn you. God doesn't have to, your heart will. Hello? He's not there to condemn you. He's there to restore you. But if you have sin, your heart will condemn you. Judge you. There's something between. Let me ask you something. Now, we went back and used that thing about husbands and wives and intimacy and, you know, adultery and pornography and stuff. Let me ask you something. Husbands and wives, if you've been married, if you've ever been married, if you and your wife have an argument, now, what doesn't happen until you get that thing straightened out? A lot of things. Intimacy. You know, you think she done forgot about it, and you come in there with that look in your eye, and she's like, I'm tired, I'm going to sleep. Why? Because there's something there. And you know it's there. You know? If you've done, now let me say, let's forget about just an argument between the two of you. How about if you've done something wrong and you know it? It's hard for you to be free with your spouse in conversation. You'll ignore them. Won't talk to them. Why? Because they might find out what you did. What's happened? Your heart's condemning you. Hello? Say maybe she put you on a diet. Hello? And she's feeding you kale. And aspartame sodas and range-free chicken grilled with nothing on it. And on your way home from work, you've had it. I can't take it anymore. So you stop at the gas station and get you a cold 2-liter out of the cooler and a candy bar. And even a couple of hot dogs you throw in the microwave. And eat all that, suck the soda down, and come in the house. How was your day, honey? It's good. What'd you eat today? Well, you know, you sent me a kale sandwich on whole wheat for lunch. You eat it? Yeah, I ate it, baby. But you're a whole time you're trying to get her to shut up. Why? Because if she asks you the other question, you're going to have to fess up. Look, I got to go upstairs. Well, supper will be ready in a minute. What are we having? We're having Boca burgers on the grill so all the non-fat can drop out. Triple filtered water at room temperature because ice is bad for your digestion. All right, I'll be back down in a little while. The whole time she, you know, and you think, I got to, what's happened? So you've shut down communication. There's no freedom because you might get to the place she's going to find out you stopped at the gas station. What happened? Your heart's condemning you now. Your stomach's jumping up and down for joy, but your heart condemns you. And so you withdraw in openness and freedom of fellowship because your heart's condemning you. Now, we have people teaching in the body of Christ today that you don't confess your sin. You simply look at the finished work of Jesus and that takes care of everything. The problem with that is your heart condemns you. Because you know when you come into the presence of a holy God and you went out and you know you did something wrong today. I mean, you flipped off the other guy beside you. Christians do that? We could bring it right up here and show you a couple in the church that used to go to our church. one guy blew by one guy, and the guy in the church flipped him off, and then they got a phone call. Hey, brother, appreciate you flipping me off.
I was waving.
With my middle finger. Yeah, watched Top Gun too many times. We were communicating, you know, giving them the bird. Yeah, ghost, I know what it is. All right. When we are, so we got people teaching people that used to, you don't have to confess that. The confessing of a sin in your life is not biblical because you're under grace and it's a work of the law. And what's happening? It's like going to your buddies at work and you did all that stuff at the gas station the day before and said, man, I went home last night and my wife was cooking, you know, Boca burgers and I had stopped off at Sheets and got me a 2-liter and 2 hot dogs and, you know, and a candy bar. And I said, man, just don't tell her. What you don't know won't hurt. But it's hurting you. Because now you're hiding something. And you're breaking intimacy with your spouse.
Yep, yeah, that's good.
Did you stop at Sheets?
No, I didn't.
I really didn't. Just messing.
I have, though.
Yeah. This is the voice of experience.
Yeah.
Jane tried to put me on a diet, and all of a sudden, I got to go fill it with gas. Zero bar to Dr. Pepper. Woo! And then she'll say, did you get gas today? Yeah, baby. What else did you get? Dr. Pepper. And? Zero bar. What else?
Oh, man.
A glazed honey bun.
Oh.
Hallelujah. You know, I've stopped. I had to stop doing that because, you know, I felt so bad. But it was so good. Sin has pleasure for a season.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, that's true.
The Bible says that. Sin has pleasure for a season.
Yeah.
And so what happens when people are teaching people that they don't confess their sin, you're not confessing it for God's sake. You're confessing it for your own. So that once again, there's nothing between you and the Father, and your heart won't condemn you before the Father. And you can have confidence towards Him. And you can ask and receive of Him.
Yeah.
If we ask anything according to His will, we know He hears us. And if we know He hears us, we had the petition we desired of Him. But in that same part of the Bible, it tells us that if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence toward God. So all the proponents of 1 John 1:9 doesn't belong to church, you don't confess your sins, are just full of junk. Bunk and Tommy rot. Because they're hurting people in the process of getting things between them and the Father out of the way from their end. So you're told, I'm righteous, and you're under grace, and it doesn't matter what you do. It does matter because your heart will condemn you if you do it. It knows it's wrong, and it should not be in the presence of the Father. He's a holy God. I said He's a holy God. And He says, be holy even as I am holy. Well, all I got to do is look at the finished work of Jesus, and I am holy. Hogwash! Read your Bible a little bit better than some little cute saying or a cute little clip or a cute little, you know, whatever. Read things in context. Read and do an exegesis, a study. Study things deeper than shallowness. See, people don't want to do it. Study to show yourself approved. A workman that needeth not be ashamed. Instead of studying to get out of doing stuff. Hello? We all want to be rewarded for no work. Now listen, one of the worst things that ever happened to me as a student was my 11th grade, maybe my senior year, maybe my senior year, but Miss Claybrook. Now Vera Claybrook was our English teacher for 11th and 12th grade. We got her both years. She taught back then what we called a ET class. It wasn't the Ed Taylor class, it was the extra talented. We're supposed to be smarter, you know, and all that kind of stuff. We got an extra GPA point on our GPA for taking her class. And my senior year was a 2-hour class. Junior year was 1 hour, but our senior year we got 2 hours. Well, in high school, you got to read John Steinbeck's The Red Badge of Courage. Y'all remember that? Yeah. And you either had to do a book report or something. Well, ours was an art project on it. And so my sister, now I'm a merged family. My parents married when I was about, between first and second grade. Between second and third grade, they got married. And I have a sister who is 6 months older than me. So we went to school together in the same grade. Okay? Well, she worked for 6 weeks, the whole marking period, or 9 weeks, whatever it was. But no, because it took her 6 weeks. I remember this. You remember those old opaque projectors? Uh-huh. I mean, you slid something in there, and there's this huge lens. It was hot as fire. You know what I mean? You could put anything in there, though, and it would show up on the wall. Right. Well, she took a picture from, Red Badge of Courage, and put it in for 6 weeks, and drew this huge poster, outlined it, colored it. I mean, it was huge. It's like a big, big, huge thing. She got a 98. In fact, she didn't get 100 is surprising. All right? The night before it was due, I sat down and traced the picture, colored it in, turned it in, got a 93. Now, let me tell you something. To an athlete in high school who doesn't like school to start with, 5 points won't worth 6 weeks.
Right.
Worst thing that ever happened to me. Taught me, man, you can do it by the seat of your pants and still get a good grade. And it was an A-, but it was an A. And besides, I didn't have to do all that work for every afternoon after school for 3 hours a day for 6 weeks doing all this stuff. It took her like 3 weeks just to trace the thing. I did it one night, baby. Yeah. Taught me to be lazy. But here's the thing. If we don't teach the church to be disciplined, Jesus said go and make disciples out of men. We'll teach them to be lazy. And then we love doctrines and we love teachings that let us get away with doing anything without any effort on our part or any requirement on our part. It's all on Jesus. Well, you know what? Jesus can't make you get saved. You've got to act on that. You can't get saved. He doesn't save you without your will being involved and you doing what he said to do, to confess his lordship and believe in your heart God's raised you from the dead. There's an action you must take and there's no way around it. The condemnation in your heart of sin that's in your life is something you're going to have to deal with.
Yeah.
And simply laying down on the couch and saying, well, I know I did it. Think about this. You know you did it. But somebody told you don't confess it. So you're going there, well, I'm not going to confess it because it doesn't matter that I did it. I'm just going to look at the finished work of Jesus and know I'm under his grace. And so even though I did it, it doesn't matter. Why not just go ahead and say, Lord, forgive me? It's kind of like, I know we're running a little bit long, and I know I'm not way off my notes. I'm kind of around them. How about that? I'm on one of the runways in the same airport.
All right.
Which means we're going to get to the same terminal. Hallelujah. What was I going to say before I said that? Huh? Yeah. Oh, yeah. We're not going to ask for forgiveness anyway. Why would we go through all the effort not to confess the sin when we know we did it? We know it was wrong. We know we shouldn't have done it. How does it build your faith not to acknowledge it and ask God to forgive you? See, that's error. That's an error teaching. Because your heart's still sitting down there going, yeah, I did. I need to get that right. Oh, no. That's a work of the law for you to confess that. No, it's not. It's like you've done something wrong to somebody and they know it, but your heart condition, and you avoid them every time you see them because you did them wrong. Now, they love you. They haven't rejected you, but you won't have anything to do with them because you did them wrong. So you avoid them every time you get a chance. Why? Because you feel bad about what you did. And if you are in the presence, you can't be real. You got to kind of deflect and defer everything. Because you can't get to the place of, I need to deal with this. Amen. So things have to be dealt with. Things need to be cleaned up and cleared up. Well, so we can move forward. So we don't have to break fellowship and break relationships and break intimacy. You understand why I use intimacy? We're not always talking about. See, we're such a stupid, sex-crave world. You can't say certain things without people going. There's more to intimacy than sex. You can have intimate relationships with people where you love them and you're friends and you're close and you're, you know, as Anne of Avonlea says, bosom buddies. Y'all remember Anne of Green Gables, Anne of Avonlea? Yeah. I think Anne's pretty cool. My kids grew up on Anne. Daddy watches it with them. I'm the chick flick dad. I sit down with my kids and watch. Me and Shannon will have Pride and Prejudice night, the BBC version, A&E BBC version. There's five, you know, it's five, oh, it's 50-minute videos, so it's 5 hours or something. Me and Shannon will sit down. Sometimes we'll try to watch them all in a row. Try to get it going early enough that we can sit there and watch all 5 hours back to back. And Shannon quotes the whole movie. Yeah, and she's IMDb, and, you know, well, I ask her, well, what about this? The International Movie Database. That's it. Well, if you want to get me something, get me the remastered Blu-ray version. Now that we're talking about buying the movie, because we used to have the videos recorded off of television, the first time we saw it. Then we bought the VHSs, then we bought the DVDs, then we bought the remastered DVDs. Now it's on Blu-ray. And every time we get the new version or the new updated version, we got to watch it all over again. How the time I got off on that? Oh, because intimacy can be about closeness. See, and biblically that is being close with God. Being intimate with God is being close with God. And sin in your heart will break that. I know we've covered a lot of ground on that, kind of hammered on that, but I am telling you, if you don't confess stuff that breaks that, when your heart condemns you, you're setting yourself up for failure. Because your heart will condemn you and you will not have confidence toward God. If you don't have confidence toward God, you can't get answers to prayer. And your faith won't work. Amen?